Okay, well, with that, I will turn it over to Bryce to introduce today's program.
It's my pleasure today to introduce Professor Jim Moore, Associate Professor of Politics and Government and Director of Political Outreach for the Tom McCall Center for Civic Engagement. He's going to talk to us about this most recent election. Thank you.
So here we go. It's good to see all of you again. I'm going to share my screen, which sometimes takes a little bit for it to go. There we go. Look at that. A long, strange trip, but not too strange it ended up. So just to give away the end, the biggest surprise of this election for me was that the Oregon legislature basically didn't change much in terms of the partisan breakdown, and the Congress, the Senate and the House, didn't change much either. Everybody was looking for all this stuff and the change, and Democrats were hoping there was a blue something, and Republicans were saying about 6 months ago, no, no, we're going to have a red something, and they all just something together. So we're going to have a new president, but all the rest of the stuff, it's a long, strange trip. So let's look at the president first. This is as of about an hour ago. Biden is up by about 5 million votes. So you can see right up there. It's not clear how many votes there are still out to be counted. People initially said 150 million. Now they're saying 160 million. So we'll find out in the next week or so how many votes there actually are. But they're getting close to 150 million right now. Electoral College, Biden's at 279. He could go to 306, most likely with Arizona and Georgia, but he doesn't need him to win. Trump is at 217. Alaska was just given to him. I don't know why it was not before, but there you go. North Carolina, he will get as well. So he's going to go to 232 for sure. Just a little, my own little brag, my range for Biden was 279 to 334. So we're right at the bottom of my range right now, and 306 is right in the middle of my range. So it's always good to get something vaguely right in these kinds of things. Looking at the presidential race here in Oregon, Biden wins 56.5% to Trump's 40.3. That gives us an interesting thing. Right now, we're the Biden's victory is number 13 in terms of margins of victory for presidential candidates in Oregon. So right between Obama, that you will all remember, and if anybody remembers the McKinley victory over William Jennings Bryan in 1900, my hat is off to you. But that was number 14 right now. This is Oregon's been voting for Democratic presidential candidates 9 times in a row now since 1988. If we continue to do it, and I don't see any reason we wouldn't, we will tie the record for partisan straight times, which is 10 Republicans in a row, 1870s to the early 1900s. Washington County becomes a really interesting place in the presidential race. So in the year 2000, Gore beats Bush 48 to 46%. This is statewide. Gore beat Bush by just 7,000 votes. The second closest election we've ever had in the state. Here we are 20 years later in the county, Biden beats Trump 65% to 31%. So what does that mean? Well, look at this, Multnomah County in 2000, 64%, 28%. Familiar looking there, huh? Washington County is now basically, in terms of its Democratic identity, about where Multnomah County was 20 years ago. Whether that continues, this time Biden beat Trump by about, last I saw, it was about 78% to 22% in Multnomah County. I don't know if we'll go that far in Washington County, but 20 years ago, we were a battleground place for Republicans. This was where the Republican legislature was centered, all sorts of things like that, and we profoundly changed, as we'll see in just a bit as well. So as we look at the federal races in Oregon, basically, no big mysteries there. U.S. Senate race, Suzanne Bonamici, Earl Blumenauer, Kurt Schrader. We have the single Republican in our congressional group. Cliff Bentz is the new guy from going the wrong way here. Back. There we are. I gave one of these talks as I'm doing this on my iPad because I get the pointer on it. I discovered that I gesture. And so I knocked my iPad off several times. So I'm trying not to do that, but I still knock things. The big thing is Cliff Bentz here in the 2nd Congressional District. So he becomes our sole Republican in our congressional delegation. And then Peter DeFazio in the 4th Congressional District had to work a bit, but he won. You know, I've been living here since 1990. I've been paying attention to Oregon politics for 20 years before that. Well, 25 years before that. And I've done research going back. I've never found a time when the 4th Congressional District was advertising in the Portland metropolitan area for a race. But this was one of those times. So a close race, but DeFazio, as expected, won. Statewide offices, basically, the Democrats continue their run and they get back the Secretary of State position that they lost 4 years ago. Shamia Fagan gets the Secretary of State's race. Attorney Ellen Journey, General Rosenblum wins easily. Tobias Reed, he won more easily than he did against the same guy. And Jeff, in 2016, he beat Goodman by 2.4% of the vote, this time 10.3% of the vote. I'm actually giving a talk tomorrow that Jeff Goodman usually shows up to, so I'll be interested to see if he has anything to say about what on earth he was doing in his campaign. Statewide, Republicans averaged 42% of the vote, and that's a number that we've basically seen for the last 10 to 15 years. Republicans have a real hard time getting beyond the 40-ish percent range. Democrats averaged 52.7% of the vote. That's also norm for the last 10 to 15 years. Note that in the presidential race, Biden got more than the Democratic average and Trump got less than the Republican average. More people voted in the presidential vote than they did for any of these other statewide races. Differences were about 120,000 between the two of them. I was just putting together a blog entry for a statewide blog that talks about a variety of things. And that 110, 120,000 difference is the total registered voting population of the least populated 13 states or 13 counties in Oregon. So it's a significant difference in terms of the number of people. We call that the undervote. The difference between what people vote for, how many vote for the top of the ticket, and how many then vote later on down in the weeds as we're looking at things. Statewide ballot measures, no big surprises here, but the big one was the one that didn't happen, and that's the nicotine tax for health programs on 108. This same measure was on the ballot in California a few years ago, and the people who were in favor of it raised a lot of money, like $30 million-ish dollars. And then Big Tobacco said, we aren't gonna like that at all. And they came in with $70 million to oppose it. That California measure passed about this amount, about what we passed at 66 to 34%. So this time the people behind Measure 108 raised a lot of money for Oregon. They had $14 million, most of it from the big health organizations here. So from Kaiser, Peace Health, from all those kinds of things, contributed millions and millions of dollars. And then Big Tobacco didn't show up. Measure 108 did spend all their money. They weren't going to let it just sit there. But they didn't encounter the big response from Big Tobacco that we saw in California, probably because Big Tobacco learned from California the people really like this kind of a tax and really like those kinds of programs. So that's the big thing. The ones that got us international attention clearly are medical psilocybin and decriminalizing hard drugs. Decriminalizing hard drugs, big deal for the United States, but there are countries in Europe that have been doing this for the past almost 30 years. So it's you know, in the European point of view, we're kind of catching up. From the American point of view, we're breaking ground with our drug policies and the way we're dealing with them. And we'll see how they turn out. It's you know, a lot of this is, for me as a social scientist, fun because it's experiments. But for us as people who are the taxpayers and looking at programs, it'd be nice to have a little bit more certainty how all this is going to work. But Oregon will be the experimental place where we go through this stuff. Oregon legislature, once again, as I said at the very beginning, not much change at all. in 2019, 18 Democrats, 12 Republicans. 2021, this next one, 18 Democrats, 12 Republicans. Basically, there was a switch. Republicans picked up one seat, Democrats picked up a seat, and then Tim Knopf and Bend held on by just a few thousand votes, especially like 1,400 votes last I looked. That's one that Democrats targeted, but this was never going to be one. Remember, this is where the 12 Republicans walked out three times in the legislative sessions to prevent a quorum. And there were some Democrats saying, oh, we should get to having 20 Democrats because that's a quorum. And those of us who were looking carefully said, that's a big ask. That's a really big ask. And it turns out it was. They were not able to go there. Interesting dynamic. We'll get to this a little bit later. But in Oregon, when people turn in their ballots, you can, it's every day when ballots come in, it's marked how many Republicans turn in their ballots, how many Democrats turn in their ballots, and the other parties as well. And usually what happens is the Democrats and Republicans are really even in terms of turning in their ballots every single day. And we get to the end in a terms of a rate, Republicans will have a higher rate of return, say 85%, as compared to Democrats, say 82%. But this time, Democrats were ahead at all those dates going up. We do not have the data from Election Day itself. Late-breaking votes favored Republicans in these two Senate districts that were hot races here, which is evidence to me that more Republicans turned in their ballots on the last day, dropped them off. But it didn't happen statewide. It just happened in select places, a few House districts and a few Senate districts. So it wasn't a statewide phenomenon. So that'll be data that I'm looking for later on. What was that actual party breakdown on the last day? Oregon House, same kind of thing. We get started out 38 Democrats, 22 Republicans. And lo and behold, we're going to get 37 Democrats and 23 Republicans. Supermajority to pass taxes with no other votes is 36. So the Democrats still have that supermajority. The odd historical thing, since 1955, it's only had one party has only had 38 seats four times. And it's never gone above 38. I have no idea why. In the Senate, it has happened that one party or the other, usually the Republicans, slips down into the single digits. Notably in the 70s, there was a time when the Republicans had just six people in their caucus in the state Senate. A photographer from Klamath Falls said, oh, I have an idea. And so they were called the phone booth caucus because a picture was taken of them in the Capitol stuck into a phone booth. They could all fit. So it happens in the Senate, but it doesn't happen in the House, and it continued not to happen in the House. The Republicans flipped a couple of coastal districts. House District 32 is the one on the North Coast, so it comes over into Washington County just a little bit. Democrats flipped a Bend district, so it basically didn't change much. And then the bottom is those late-breaking Republican surges. Very interesting that they just didn't go statewide, but just in these places. House District 31 there is our neighbor just to the north. This is Bill Witt. And so he's just ahead by a few hundred, whereas he was ahead by a couple of thousand on election night. So clearly people in Scappoose and things like that, Republicans really turned out on that last day there. Washington County, we can, in your questions, get into Washington County, but Beaverton. So 20 to 25 years ago, this was the center of where Republicans were in power, but the moderate Republicans were being replaced in the primaries. They were being knocked off by social conservative Republicans. So it was happening in Beaverton. It also happened coming out into our part of Washington County as well. So what do we have now, 20, 25 years later? Four progressive Democrats, all of them young women, three of them women of color, all winning office. Winsley Campos, the one down there at the bottom of the list there, Pacific class of 16. So she's like 25, 26 years old. All of them are in their 20s or 30s. Something's in the water in Beaverton. This may be a key to why we're seeing the Washington County presidential rates equal what Multnomah County looked like 20 years ago. Beaverton may be where that shift is going stronger than it is in other places. So that's just a fascinating thing. We'll be watching closely and notice that they're in a variety of places. So County Commission, Beaverton City Council, and then Winsvay is in the Oregon House. Oddly enough, Winsvay in the Oregon House, Pacific grad, the Republican who won the Senate seat that used to be Democratic, is Pacific grad of 72. He actually contacted me and said ever since he thought he was running, he wanted to make sure he contacted me so I knew that students could go there and have internships. So he's on the list. We'll get that going. So this is data stuff. So here's daily ballot returns by party. Blue is Democrats and red is Republicans. Green is other parties. So the Green Party, the Independent Party, and gray is unaffiliated. Okay, so you can see usually the blue and the red are exactly with each other, but there was this big blue push here, which since it happened nationwide, the same pattern has got to be enthusiasm to vote for the Biden ticket over the Trump ticket. But it began to narrow, and I don't have the data for election today to see if the Republicans caught up. They should actually end up a little bit higher if it's any other year. And so that data waits to be seen there. But just fascinating that the Democrats were just getting their ballots in so much more quickly than the Republicans. This is by percentage of registered voters. So this doesn't break down by party. This is just the percent of registered voters. Once again, we're basically the purple one is this year. And this is just presidential elections going back to 2000. So it's just the vote by mail elections because that's where we have this data. So the purple, we were just ahead in terms of percentage of registered voters every day. People were getting those ballots in earlier. And then this is Friday before the election, Monday before the election, and election day. And there the numbers finally caught up. So our final numbers here are, we'll see them in just a bit, we're at like 81.7. And the highest ones that we've had are kind of 85-ish. But usually there's just a big bunch of ballots. Sometimes as many as 40% of the ballots come in on Monday and Tuesday. This time that didn't happen. So the percentage ended up being normal, but it looked really strong for the Democrats all this way going ahead here. Then we look at the daily ballot returns by actual numbers. We have a lot more registered voters right now. We got over 2.9 million registered voters. This is up significantly. It's all because of DMV registration. People are just automatically registered when they go to the DMV. So this is, you know, there's no catching up here at the end. The number of actual voters, man, it started out high. Once again, we're the purple, and it just ended high. The previous record, 2.05 million, more or less, we're at 2.41 million right now. So a significant jump just in the number of voters. But as you recall back to the bi-party, the unaffiliated voters are not voting at a huge rate. They're usually 30 to 40% lower than the partisan voters. So this is really generated by people who are in the parties and are just really enthusiastic to get their votes in there. Okay, and then this just looks since 1960, the presidential elections. So the percentage of registered voters that voted in every election, that average is through 2016. I have not adjusted it for the 2020 numbers, but that's 81% is the average. So you can see we're just a smidge above it in 2020 there right now, right over here. But you can see, boy, in the early 60s, we had big turnouts. And then in the 70s, we kind of all went to sleep. And then we got up into the 2000s and began to be a little bit up here. So this was not a record turnout in terms of percentages at all. But once again, let's look at the actual numbers. Yes, indeed. Huge, huge difference in the number of voters there. Just as a little comparison, I am finishing up the darn book on Vicatia. COVID-19, oddly, has put a lot of things in the way of me getting the darn thing done. But by Wednesday before the election. So we had Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Monday, Tuesday of ballots to come in. By that date, more people had voted in Oregon than voted in Vic's first victorious election in 1978. So it's just a huge number of people who are turning out to vote that we didn't have before. So that's it's pretty remarkable. Pretty remarkable. So when we look at all this, you know, the key things from this election are generated by the presidential race, people turned out. So we're getting a better representation of who we are as a people by looking at the votes. Nationally, there is some indication, if we go to 160 million, and I'm not sure we will, that'll be two-thirds of people who were registered to vote voted. And the United States is famous for being really happy if we get over 50% in a presidential election. So that's a big number. That also, and this may get to one of the questions one of you have, it may be why the polls were wrong in some places. They were actually pretty good nationally, but some of those states were really hard to work out. And there's one of the hypotheses is that the pollsters didn't do a good job figuring out who these new voters were coming in and casting ballots, sometimes for the very first time ever. So that's good. The closest of the race, remember, if we look at the general numbers, Biden's ahead by 5 million. This is not a close race. And the rest of the world would say, wow, Biden's the president. But we have the Electoral College, and the Electoral College, which no other country has adopted ever, the Electoral College makes it close. And that's why we're waiting for the president to concede, which he probably won't do. But we're waiting kind of for finalization of what the Electoral College actually says. If this were any other country, we would have done the count and it would have been pretty clear by Wednesday morning that Biden was going to be the president simply because of the nationwide numbers of votes. Here in Oregon, things don't change very much. So if you're a Republican in the Senate and you walked out, you heard from your voters this time, they approved of you walking out. So watch for the walkout to be a tactic that comes up in the session that's coming up. If the Democrats try to push anything big and controversial like cap and trade, but you can think of there's other things that they might push. The Republicans found out it's a tactic that worked. And it's a tactic that their voters did not punish them for, in fact, seemed to support them for. So that'll be an interesting dynamic as we go through and watch. One interesting thing about this election, just nationally and here in Oregon, you know, you saw the ads and social media, the ads that you were getting if you got flyers, if you were in a district where that happened, if in the stuff that you saw on television, heard on the radio, it was all about how bad the other character was who was running for the office. And so we don't really have a good sense about what issues people want to deal with as they move forward in the Oregon legislative session and what issues they want to deal with as they move forward at the national level. You would think it would be healthcare, which is just always number one, and economy, which is either number one or number two. You think with COVID would be mixed in there, but because people seem to be more voting on the personality of Donald Trump at the national level, and then on what did you think about this person as a human being at the state and local level, we just don't have a clear sense of what the future big policies are going to do. Compare this to 2 years ago and 4 years ago, where in Oregon, we knew the Democrats were going to do cap and trade. Global climate change was the biggest thing on their menu. That's what they wanted to do. At the national level, it was the Republicans saying, we want to repeal Obamacare. That's the biggest thing. We don't have that clarity as we're moving forward. So that's why I said, you know, a long, strange trip. And yet it doesn't seem to change that much as we move forward. New president, but everything else kind of hangs in abeyance. So let's stop there and see if you have any questions. If you got questions, Bryce, you're the host.
I have a question.
Okay.
You haven't mentioned your view of the likelihood of there being fraud, election fraud in any state.
Yeah.
So where are you on that?
Well, I'm where the facts are. There is no fraud in any state, period. The fraud that happens is very much like what we're seeing in Oregon. We don't have final counts now because the votes that are coming in that they haven't done, if you've been to the elections and watch how they do it, they look at the outside envelope, and the biggest problem is people forget to sign. And then there's times when your signature doesn't match. And so they put those over in a box, and they look and make sure that everything else is legitimate. Basically, is there something inside the envelope? And they send you a postcard saying, hey, we have these problems. Please come and resolve them, or we'll resolve them, or whatever it is. But that's where we are in Oregon, is going through those resolution things. That's exactly what's happening in all the other states right now. The big thing is the Pennsylvanias and the Georgias and the, you know, the other major states, they just didn't have the expertise that we built up over how to run vote by mail. And you may remember our elections here, 2000 and 2004, those first three, things were really clunky and took a real long time. It took us a long time to figure out how you get resources in the right place, get people trained to do X, you know, what pattern do the ballots come in? So I need a lot of extra people on this day when a bunch of them come in. They're learning on the fly in those states. But talking to Republican and Democratic voter people, mainly the secretaries of state in every single state, none of them pointed out any fraud at all beyond the normal. Basically, you didn't sign the ballot right, and we have to ask you to go do it again, that kind of thing. Another thing that makes it more complicated is it's not clear in some of those states if the state legislature should have passed a law, and sometimes they did, sometimes they didn't. If the secretary of state or the governor can kind of say, this is the way the system's going to work. And so that's where there's the edge where the Trump people can go in and say, oh, wait, this isn't exactly what you intended to do, so you need to discount these ballots, that kind of thing. So it won't be a fraud issue. It'll be, did you legally cross all your T's and dot all your I's so that this was a legitimate election in the way that you actually ran it compared to what your state laws are? That'll be the big, big issue if there's any changes when it goes into the courts.
We did get a question in the chat, just if you had any comments on the Georgia runoff.
Yeah. Geez, Georgia's confusing everybody. given Georgia, I think that the Republicans will do just fine and win both runoffs, simply because there was a huge voter turnout there, just as there was nationwide, and there will be a lower voter turnout when they do the runoffs. It's just that simple. And Republicans tend to be more motivated, although in Georgia, you know, this is where Stacey Abrams is from, and she lost a close election and those kinds of things. The Democrats have learned we've got to get people motivated when it's one of these weird elections, a runoff election. But going in, the Republicans are favored. They're absolutely favored. The thing is that the Democrats are holding on to hope, because the Democrats won two Senate seats. They converted two Senate seats, but they needed to convert four. And so they're hoping that they're going to win both of these, but I think the odds are pretty much against them. So could happen. But quite frankly, though, you know, I never thought that I'd see Georgia leaning towards a Democratic candidate for president at this point. I would have expected it maybe 4 years or 8 years down the road, simply because of demographic change. But this was a little bit early for that as well. So Janine, Pamela Jean, do you see the U.S. moving away from the Electoral College and going to straight popular vote? No! You know, think about if we'd had the situation where Trump had won the Electoral College vote and lost the popular vote, as he did in 2016. That would have been three times in 20 years that it had happened. And after two times in 16 years, there was no serious movement to get rid of the Electoral College. And the reason is pretty simple. The smaller states see the Electoral College as giving them a larger voice. And if you're a battleground state, you can actually make a difference in what's going on in the presidential race. If not, if we get rid of the Electoral College, it's basically going to the big cities. And, you know, like Oregon in 2000 and 2004, we were a battleground state. The campaigns came here. In 2004, we had that one wonderful day when the Kerry campaign was in Portland and the Bush campaign was in Portland, and they were trying to get the television cameras to point at each other as they were doing the same thing. It was wonderful. And then we stopped being a battleground state and we don't see that. So the politics are just against it. Once again, no other country in the world has copied this at all. Okay. Howard.
Let me unmute. Jim, thank you for your information. What's the process moving forward as we move toward January 20th?
At the presidential level?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a couple things going on. First of all, it matters not one bit whether Biden claims that he won the presidency or Trump claims that he won the presidency. The actual decision is made by the states. That's it. And so the states will make their official certifications and they'll say, this is the winner of the race. So that's step one. So usually it's a 2.5 to about 4 week period before you get the official certification. So we'll see that. Secondly, then is the Electoral College. So the Electoral College people meet as prescribed by law because the Constitution says you got to make this work. So they meet in December in the state capitals and they officially cast their Electoral College ballots. Okay. Now, remember, 4 years ago, this was an issue in Washington State because there were a couple of electors there for Biden who said, no, we're not going to do that. And there was all this thing. And it went to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court said, if there are rules that the state says you have to vote a certain way, like how the popular vote was in your state, then you have to do that. You can't be what's called a faithless elector. But there are a number of states where they don't have those rules. And so we may see faithless electors. There's also ambiguity in the Constitution. It says the states decide what the Electoral College votes are. It doesn't say how they decide. And so there's this weird movement going on to have state legislatures that are run by Republicans overrule the will of the people that might have voted for Biden to get the electors to vote for Trump instead of Biden. I don't think that's going anywhere, but it's nice, you know, if you've had a lot of drinks in the back of the bar to think about it. So that's step two. Step three. Then the official results are reported to Congress. This happens in January after the new Congress has been seated. If there is no candidate that has 270 votes, then you go to Constitutional Plan B, which is the House of Representatives decides by each having a single vote per state. So California gets a single vote, Wyoming gets a single vote. And so if there's a split delegation, whatever the majority of that delegation is, we'll do it. We'll make the decision. We've never gone this way. We have gone this way. And then it was totally partisan. I'd be hard pressed to see a state once again that went one way to have its House delegation go the other way, because the will of the people would come back and say, what on earth did you just do? But it could happen. Okay, and then we get to the final thing. Then there's the parallel thing, which is after 9/11, one of the findings of the 9/11 Commission was that the Bush administration was not prepared in the intelligence community in terms of the public safety and all that stuff for 9/11 and the aftermath, because there had been a poor transition from the Clinton administration to the Bush administration. And part of it was the Bush people and the Clinton people just didn't get along very well. Part of it was that, remember, the Supreme Court didn't decide that race until the 12th of December. And so legislation was passed by Congress saying, here's how it's going to work. We don't want to have the new president not be ready to go on January 20th when they take the oath of office. Right now, the key to that is that the head of the General Services Administration, of all people, is empowered to be the one who says, I signed this, and that begins the official transition. She has refused to even take questions on whether or not she's going to do that in the future. And the reason she is because the president is claiming I've won, or there are challenges, so it's not settled. Once again, it's not up to him to make those choices. It's up to the states to make those choices. So that's fine, and that's politics, and that'll be interesting. But once enough states have certified their election results, if she still does not sign things, then we've got deep trouble. Because there's no excuse then for her not signing and getting the transition officially going. At the top levels, there are problems. The political appointees and the president have said, directed their people, don't cooperate with the Biden people. But at the lower levels, there are not problems because the Biden people have been cooperating with the people who currently serve in those positions for months now, just in case, because that's what you do when you're running for president. So they're ready at those lower levels for the transition to happen, and it's already happening. It's at the top level that's the problem. So that'll be where the news is and things like that, but that's where we are. So it's long and weird and complex. I was doing interviews with a radio station in London. They liked me so much, they called me back and I did another one. But they were saying, what on earth is this? It's 75 days from the election until the president moves in and takes power. You know, we have elections. I said, I know, I'm very familiar with elections. The prime minister loses and then goes home. And that night, home is not number 10. They've already moved you out. We have this. And remember, it used to be March 4th for us. We tightened it up because, oh, so many things were happening. The Great Depression was the main thing. We need to get things going. And now we're finding that 75 days may be too long as well. But that's basically the process.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Go ahead, Paul.
Okay. Is there a definite timeline that things have to happen? Are there certain dates that things have to be done in the presidential election, or can this just go on and on and on?
There are absolute set deadlines. It's not clear, though, what happens if you miss a deadline. So the deadline, I don't have this exactly in my head, but I believe the deadline for the actual electoral college votes is the 14th of December. Okay. And so that was significant in 2000 because the Supreme Court ruled on the 12th of December. And so Florida knew that it was going to report its electoral college votes by the deadline, and that would be it. And the presidency would definitely go to George Bush. So it's not clear what happens if you miss the deadlines moving forward. So hard and fast deadlines for each state and when they certify, but there's 51 of those because District of Columbia also gets to vote. So they're scattered around. But then the electoral colleges, X date. The report to Congress is X date. I believe it's the 5th or the 6th of January. Once again, it's in the law. You can look it up. And then the 20th, no matter what happens, whether or not there has been an oath of office taken, whether or not Trump has decided that he's not going to concede or even show up, at 12 o'clock, Biden is the new president, regardless of any of that ceremonial stuff. So those are hard and fast dates. I imagine there's wiggle room in the January one and the December one if things are in courts and things like that. But no, it's never been tested. Never been tested. Anything else? Great, you had a barn burner of a city council race. That was kind of fun. I'm waiting to see kind of who got that third spot. Okay, great.
Thank you so much. This is Dr. Jim Moore. He's joined us before, and we hope that in the future you can come back again. It's always a learning experience to kind of go through the aftermath and to see where we're at and to understand the process. So thank you so much.